would have the honor and pleasure of introducing today's speaker. Dr. Nwando is a board-certified family physician who specializes in refugee and immigrant health. She's the founder and CEO of Inspire Health Solutions and the Association of Minority Women Professionals, and has led a very successful national program to improve the experiences of women of diverse backgrounds across the nation. She currently serves as the inaugural Chief Health Equity Officer and Senior Vice President for Humana. I think we've heard of them. Prior to this, she served as professor and chair of the Ohio State University Department of Family and Community Medicine, and she continues to serve as an adjunct professor at the Ohio State University's College of Medicine and College of Public Health. Dr. Nwando, it is such an honor to have you today. Welcome.
Thank you so much for having me. Thank you for that wonderful introduction. It is an honor to be here with you all today and looking forward to our conversation. I'm hoping that you will all use the chat and engage as much as you possibly can. Use the Q&A function, I believe, that'll be available to you, and really hoping to have a good dialogue with all of you today. So it is truly a pleasure to be here. I'm really looking forward to talking with you all today about implicit bias in healthcare, both how it shows up and what you can do about it. And I'm hoping that many of you have the opportunity to do a little bit of searching around your own biases and see how what implicit biases you might have already. And if you did that, I'd be interested in hearing if anything surprised you, if anything jumped out at you, because I know for sure what the first time I did that test, I was surprised at some of the biases that I have. But what we're not going to do today is say that because you have implicit biases, you are bad, or you have bad thoughts or bad intentions. What we're going to say is that we all have them, but we really just need to know what can we do about them when we have them, and how can we show up better for our patients, for our communities, for those that we serve, recognizing that these might be here. And so that's what we're hoping to impart you with today. So to do this, I'm going to be joined by two incredible colleagues of mine who I'm really looking forward to introducing you to. Just so I do them justice, I'm going to just read a little bit from their bios. I'm going to first introduce Ms. Candy Magana. She is a nationally respected practice facilitator, master trainer, and a professional in clinical transformation. She has lots of capacity building and innovation adoption expertise. She currently serves as the Director of Health Equity Innovation Solutions and Transformation on my Health Equity and Social Impact team at Humana. And in this role, she leads a team that drives a lot of enterprise-wide innovation related to health literacy, cultural competency, cultural humility, and quality improvement to further support our health equity strategy. She's also an adjunct assistant professor at the Ohio State University College of Medicine in the Department of Family and Community Medicine. And she previously served there as their director of the Center for Primary Care Innovation and Transformation. Candy is a graduate of Johns Hopkins University and holds her master's in public administration from New York University. Then my second colleague that will be joining me is soon to be Dr. Deborah Fadoju, who I will have the honor of seeing graduate from The Ohio State University College of Medicine in just a few weeks. She's currently a fourth year medical student, graduated from Howard University as an undergraduate. She is going to be a resident physician in obstetrics and gynecology, which she just matched in last week. So very excited for her. But as a student, Debbie has been recognized nationally as an activist, community organizer, and an outspoken leader who has championed lots of work in anti-racism efforts in the medical community, including transforming some of the curriculum at The Ohio State University College of Medicine. She's a National Merit Foundation Sylvia B. Kelly Scholar recognized leader for championing anti-racism efforts in obstetrics and gynecology. At The Ohio State University College of Medicine, she served as the president of the Student National Medical Association, co-founder of Black Women in Medicine, and the OSU College of Medicine chapter of White Coats for Black Lives. She has testified before Congress, and she has led marches, and she has also inspired students and her faculty members across the university, but also across the nation. So I am really, really pleased to have these two illustrious women to join me today in this conversation. None of us has any disclosures to report. Just think it's important to share that. You know our kind of our places of work or school, so those will come up, and you might hear me say the Ohio State University multiple times during this conversation. Can't get enough of saying that. I'm a double graduate of the Ohio State University and living in Columbus, Ohio. So that is a really important thing. You will notice the slides are red. And so I may bleed a little bit Buckeye, but hopefully that won't offend anybody in this conversation. So today what we're gonna do are three things. We're gonna define the impact of historical racism and other forms of discrimination and the provision of healthcare. We're gonna learn methods of how to evaluate the presence and extent of implicit bias, which some of you did already in your IAT. And then, but most importantly, we're gonna look at some measures that can be taken to reduce those biases. And I think it's really important for all of us, particularly those of us as clinicians who are on the front lines of care, to recognize how we can show up better in more compassionate and humble ways for the patients that we care for. So the first thing I want to do before we get into all of the conversations is I'm going to play a short video for you. So I'm going to just switch over to another screen really quickly and play this for you. You might have already seen this, but I do want to make sure that that you can all hear it. So Candy, there's something you said that I need to do when I do this. I'm going to make sure I did it.
In the lower left hand screen, once you share screen, just click share the audio. Okay, so on your from your computer.
Okay. All right. So I'm going to have you all just watch a couple minutes. I'm not going to play the whole thing of this video, and hopefully you can all hear it. Please let me know if you cannot.
All right. What's your name, darling?
My name is Susan Boyle.
Okay, Susan. And where are you from?
I am from Blackburn near Bathgate, West Lothian.
It's a big town.
It's a sort of collection of, villages. I to think there.
And how old are you, Susan?
I am 47. And that's just one side of me.
Hello. Okay, what's the dream?
I'm trying to be a professional singer.
And why hasn't it worked out so far, Susan?
I've never been given the chance before, but here's hoping it'll change.
Okay, and who would you like to be as successful as?
Elaine Page.
Elaine Page.
Like, what are you going to sing tonight?
I'm going to sing I Dreamed a Dream from the Miserables.
Okay. Big song.
Yeah? Yes.
I dreamed a dream in time gone by.
Okay, so I'm gonna stop it there, and I would love to just jump back into our conversation, but I think maybe many of you have heard about the Susan Boyle story on Britain's Got Talent, Scottish woman who came in and competed. And I would love if you have the opportunity to share some thoughts and reflections. What jumped out at you in that story? And in that, you know, short 2 minutes, you can certainly watch the longer version of that if you have not seen it. What are some things that people thought, observed as they saw that piece? And so maybe Candy or Debbie, I'd love for you to tell me what is maybe popping up, because I can't totally see the chat.
Hi, Dr. O. So for me, I think it was the immediate reaction, right? They hadn't even seen her sing. And poor Susan, there was laughter. I think they showed it immediately and just how they were even judging her from the get-go.
Yeah. Anything in the chat, Candy, that is coming up, just so we can see? Debbie, anything you want to add to that?
Yeah, I was going to just read some of the chat comments. People are saying ageism.
Yeah.
People are saying they doubted her based off of her appearance, the judge's reactions prior to her singing versus their reactions after she sang. And then someone screamed, "She proved everyone wrong."
Yeah. So I'll take, yeah. So that's a great one. Great one. Thank you for reading those. Yeah. And so, you know, it's such a remarkable story because it shows how we just make some decisions about people in a very, very quick, you know, they say it takes less than 7 seconds to form an impression, and absolutely proved everyone wrong. And, you know, she went on to win and signed with Simon's record label and has had a career as a singer, but really just important to see that we all do it, might even realize we're doing it. You saw some of the people in the audience, the faces they were making when she was even just saying what she wanted to sing. So owning that and not saying that any of those folks were bad, it's a great success story, but it does show us how we might be not even realizing the kind of decisions and judgments we might be making early on when we are having conversations or connecting with people. So we're going to make sure that this conversation today is one where you are hopefully engaged. I know you go to lots of these lectures and conversations, and we don't want to talk at you the whole time. We really want to have you take some action. So I'm going to have Candy share some of what we're going to come back to towards the end so that you can be thinking about your own actions as we go through this conversation today.
Thanks, Dr. O. So again, everyone, welcome. What I wanted to quickly do was just to let you know that later on in the day, we're actually going to be asking you to think about what you specifically want to do in terms of your action plan, both short-term and long-term. And so if we can go to the next slide, Dr. O, we're going to be referencing this tool. And this is a tool to help you think about some of the specific things to help you be successful or rethink or re-strategize about what you might want to work on. The first section is just really about, like, what do you want to work on? The second step is really focused on what are some of the things that you might want to consider in terms of what can help or what may hinder you, and thinking about, like, planning around that. And step three is really about rating your confidence. So again, we'll come back to this, but just keep this in mind. What are some of the things that, again, you want to work on both short-term and long-term related to implicit bias?
Great. Thank you, Candy. And you should all have that worksheet. I think it was in the resources, but also I believe the organizers asked for you to have that open today as well, so we can get to that a little bit later. All right. So thank you, Candy, for teeing that up. And we're hoping that you'll be thinking about that as we go through. So what I'm going to do now is just give a little bit of context, that first objective that we have to make sure that we all understand some of the challenges that that show up in healthcare. And where we might be orienting some of our work and action around. I think this is a really important thing. There's a fabulous article that was written in 2015 and published in JAMA called A Silent Curriculum. You may have read it. It was by a medical student, Catherine Brooks. She was a medical student then at Brown University who felt deeply troubled, a white medical student who felt deeply troubled about what she would realize as she got to her clinical years in medical school about the way we compartmentalize, define, and just bring in our own biases to day-to-day practice. And she felt like she was learning a lot that wasn't part of the official curriculum, but what she called the silent curriculum that was teaching her how to be biased against her patients, and wrote this really compelling piece in JAMA back then about it. And one of the things that she said, and you know, this is her as a student in her early clinical years, saying, you know, if we refuse to deeply examine and challenge how racism and implicit bias affect our clinical practice, we will continue to contribute to health inequalities in a way that will remain unaddressed in our curriculum and unchallenged by generations of future physicians. So this is a real call to action by a medical student to say, we are really setting our students up and generations behind us to bring these biases more, sometimes in an implicit way, but in an explicit way to their work, and we need to do better. And so she really challenged us. And so let's talk about where does this show up, and how do we see racial and ethnic discrimination in US adults? So we know that it is really important to understand how people feel when they're interacting with us. We know we can give all the best advice to our patients in the world that we would like. If they don't feel a connection, they don't trust, they don't feel like we respect or appreciate them, it's going to be harder for them to take our actions or follow our treatment plan. But some of the data that's emerging around what people are experiencing is that 1 in 4 out of every Black and Latinx or Hispanic adults that are age 6 or older report they've been treated unfairly, or that their health concerns were not taken seriously by health professionals because of their racial and ethnic background. More than 25% of adults of color say that they don't get the care that they need or the treatment that they need and because of discrimination. And those folks that report that discrimination in the healthcare setting also report or also end up having worse health status overall. They face more economic hardships and tend to be more dissatisfied with their care. So that connection between feelings of discrimination and dissatisfaction with their care and poor health outcomes is continues to be made. And compared with many of our other high-income peer countries, the adults in our country are more likely to report perceived racial and ethnic discrimination than adults in other countries. We also see this in many other areas. So there, this is not necessarily just on racial and ethnic lines, but we see discrimination for people based on sexual orientation and gender identity. We find that more than one in five of people who identify as LGBTQ plus adults, they report of avoiding or postponing care because they are worried about disrespect or discrimination from providers. They believe that they've encountered negative experiences, and those numbers for LGBTQ plus individuals increase if they also have that additional dimension of being of color. And so this is a place where we also see discrimination showing up, or the perception of discrimination show up, and they feel it not just in healthcare, they also feel it in employment, in housing, and other parts of our sectors. Religious discrimination is another issue that comes up a lot, and it leads to stress, social isolation, and also reduction in health promoting behaviors. And so that is a challenge, and it also shows up as people delaying the seeking of medical care because of the feelings of potential discrimination. For example, women who are hijabi wearing, Muslim or Arab American women, report that wearing that hijab leads to discrimination, just as kind of a visible thing that draws discrimination for them. And then the heightened stigma after 9/11 led to pregnant women of Arab descent experiencing poor outcomes. There have been a lot of studies that have showed the aftermath of that stigmatization on things like birth outcomes, social relationships, psychological and behavioral health. And we also see this show up in a number of other areas too. It was probably no surprise to you all when I talk about infant mortality and the disparities in infant mortality. We know that Black newborns are three times as likely to die as white newborns in that newborn period. A recent study that many of you might've seen looking at racial concordance between the race of the neonatal physician taking care of an infant and the baby themselves was a really important factor in overall prediction of life and longevity for an infant. So the newborn physician racial concordance was associated with a significant improvement in mortality, and the reverse was also true. The discordance in terms of race was associated with Black infants cared for by non-Black or white physicians were more likely to die in that first period of life. Overall, we know that Native American infants and Black infants have significantly higher rates of infant mortality, lower birth weight, and challenges for the mom in the postpartum period as well. If you continue to follow those folks as they grow, we see that there are lots of other disparities, and this is not by no means exhaustive, but one of the things that's really important to orient our understanding around what are the disparities that we see and how can we kind of think about what our role is in potentially mitigating them. But as we look at chronic diseases later in life, certain infectious diseases later in life, we see that Black Americans will experience the highest rates of hypertension, diabetes, and obesity. Black mothers much less likely to receive prenatal care than their white and other counterparts. We see that Asian American Pacific Islanders are twice as likely to die from stomach and liver cancer, which in some cases could be preventable. And we're talking about cases where there's not necessarily a genetic predisposition. Tuberculosis, significantly more common among Asians than their white counterparts. Same thing as hepatitis B. Our Hispanic and Latinx brothers and sisters are much more likely to die from diabetes or liver disease, and much more likely to have children with asthma or asthma even as adults. So lots of disparities that show up in the chronic illnesses that we experience. And it's really important to flag something because the famous Audre Lorde, who was really considered the pioneer in that concept of intersectionality, you might have patients who, as I mentioned with that LGBTQ plus discrimination slide, folks feel some discrimination because of their sexual orientation or gender identity, and that is compounded by an additional level of discrimination if they are also identify as people of color. That's compounded by an additional level of discrimination if they also are lower on the socioeconomic scale. So the concept of intersectionality, that people live these multidimensional lives, there's no particular part of their identity that they can tease out or separate. They all compound to form kind of the basis of their identity and their reality. And so Audre Lorde famously said that there's no such thing as a single issue struggle because we don't live single issue lives. And so it's really important that we think about what are all the things that our patients, that our colleagues that we're working with are bringing to the table, and what are all the different parts of their identity that might be shaping the way we're interacting with them. This is kind of relatively hot off the press. This just came out less than a couple months ago. You might have all seen this in New York Times, which is there was an interactive graph that showed a really massive study looking at infant mortality and childbirth, as well as preterm birth. And this was really looking at us as a nation compared to other nations, but also us within ourselves, and looking at infant deaths, looking at preterm, and looking at kind of infant birth weight. And essentially the takeaway is what the headline kind of says here, is that even that income and higher income, higher education, this has been shown and tested in a few places, does not necessarily protect a Black infant or a Black mother from some of what we talked about earlier in terms of those maternal child health disparities. So childbirth is deadlier for a Black family, even if they're rich. And this study kind of showed that infant mortality rates for Hispanic and Asian mothers track more closely to those of white mothers than Black mothers. And you can see that the Black infant mortality is higher than all other plates, other groups. Rates of infant mortality and preterm birth rise with a women's income, but infant mortality rates fall. So that's an interesting thing. So it even kind of uncovers that childbirth and the maternal child experience is really challenged in America at large. And so we want to just really think through, how do we make sure that we are aware of these kind of challenges? If you look at the very top, what you see is that when you look at some of these markers of the health of a nation and infant mortality, even though we spend a lot of money on healthcare, we certainly kind of outsize our GDP on healthcare, the United States still falls further below most of our other industrialized Western higher income peers in almost all dimensions of things that we look at in terms of quality of care in the healthcare system. So when you think about that, what are all the things that are contributing to that? This is a framework that was developed by Dr. Joya Kriya-Perry and a few of her colleagues as they were looking at, okay, we see the problem is increased infant mortality and maternal mortality, and particularly for Black women or Indigenous Native American women and their babies. But what are some of the things that lead to it? And this framework is kind of one of those that helps us understand some structural and social determinants that actually have an impact on our health. Some of those are policies. Some of those are historical historical things like slavery, Jim Crow laws, the redlining, 13th Amendment. Some of those things are social needs, education, and some of these things are results of some of those policies that have been decided. So it's very important to kind of root ourselves in what we see as increased infant and maternal mortality in certain populations is the consequence of a lot of other things that are structural and social around that, and the impact of racism, discrimination, other forms of prejudice on different groups ends up being kind of what we see. But we also know, and I think it's really important to share, that these health inequities that we see, they actually cost us a lot of money. This is analysis that's been done by Deloitte, really, really fascinating, just done a few months ago, where they were trying to look at what is the cost of inequity? There are really good estimates that were done by the Kaiser Family Foundation a few years ago, showing that we spend $93 billion on health inequities, and if that's due to lost productivity, that's due to what it costs us to have later stage diagnosis, poor outcomes, poor later diagnosis of clinical conditions, things like that. When they did this modeling for Deloitte, they looked at what they felt like was a $320 billion problem, that if we don't address it and we still have these suspected demographic shifts that we're having, the cost of care continues to increase, our per capita spend continues to increase, those costs in 2040 will be about $1 trillion. And they looked at a few disease states, which I want to share with you, which I think is important to just see. I pulled out a couple from this really important economic modeling paper, just the diabetes and asthma ones, but I'll just kind of walk you through what you're seeing. Essentially, if you take what one disparity, and so maybe take asthma for those that live under the federal poverty level, the rate for those that are under the federal poverty level is about 11%. And which is significantly higher than those that can achieve two times our federal poverty level. So the annual cost of that to us in billions for asthma, which we all know, you know, medications, emergency department visits, lost productivity, school work, absenteeism, is about $56 billion. And just overall the annual cost, the percent of that that's associated with the disparity, they modeled it to be about 4.3%. So if we were to not have that unnecessary spend associated with that disparity, we could save about $2 billion on asthma-related disparities. And they do this for a number of different chronic conditions so we can understand how those health disparities actually overall increase our healthcare spending. Just another way of looking at it for a few other things, you know, delays in diagnosis of cancer, unmanaged or poorly controlled diabetes or risk of heart disease. So lots of places where the unnecessary spend is contributing to our overall kind of economics as a nation. All right, so that's a little bit of background there. And so now what we wanna do is really set the stage to really think through our implicit biases. You know, keep in mind what you saw, what you felt when you watched Susan Boyle come on that stage and what we saw around her, but definitely wanna give us some shared language around how we're gonna think about implicit biases. So what these are thoughts or feelings that we have that we're usually unaware of, and they actually influence our judgments, our actions, our behavior. They're certainly based on our preferences, and sometimes those implicit biases can actually lead to favorable biases, and we'll talk about that soon. If you're a Scottish person from the village that Susan Boyle was from and she walked out on that stage, your bias might have been a very favorable one towards her, like, oh, it's great to see. We know we've got lots of singers from this village, and you might have a very favorable impression of her. But this can also result in unfavorable biases that might show up in how some of those folks responded to her, the faces that they made, if they thought she was older, if they thought she was from a small little town. And they're automatic, they're unconscious, they're out of our control. So they could be like, wow, you know, my team is really productive and I feel really good about the team I work with, my care team. That's a favorable bias. If you have a bias that you're generally working with some low performers, that's an unfavorable one that will show up in how you work with people and how you relate to your colleagues and to your patients. You know, and to be clear, these aren't necessarily bad things. We need to rely on some of these biases and these different instincts, and sorry for the typo, to make our decisions on a regular basis. When we make decisions that are solely based on these instincts, that then they can be clouded by our biases. And so that's why we have to kind of pause and figure out how we react. And we'll learn about the pause framework a little bit later. And it's also important to just recognize how those things would show up in the way you provide care for people. If you hear nothing else in this conversation today, I want you to hear that we all have these implicit biases. Sometimes they're called unconscious biases, and that terminology is used pretty interchangeably. We have conscious biases that we know of. We know that they're there. No one has to tell us that they're there. But we also have those unconscious, those subconscious, those implicit biases. We all have them. We all have them. I have them. But it doesn't mean we're bad people. And that's the thing I want you to take away, because we just need to think about how we manage them and how we mitigate them when we know that they exist. Because these are actually things that evolved as we evolved as an important kind of evolutionary tactic, a strategy for us to preserve ourselves or to defend ourselves. Implicit biases have historically been useful to our ancestors as humans because they needed to quickly be able to organize information into, is this a friend or is this a foe, and differentiate quickly. And so we have a lot of mental shortcuts that we have adapted as we have evolved as humans, because those have been necessary for survival. And in the cases where you need to make immediate decisions, where there is a threat or there is a potential threat, these are actually things that could be pretty good. So we need those mental shortcuts. They're still really critical. Our minds are busy. There is some evidence that our brain is bombarded with 11 million pieces of information at any given time. And we can only process about 40 of those things that we're bombarded with. And so we've got to think through, how do we create shortcuts to help our minds get through the things that we need to get through, to make decisions in many cases where we don't have lots of time to make them. And so that's why implicit bias continue to flourish and fluster, because we do need them for some parts of our identity. So when do they show up? So they show up automatically. So let's be clear about that. We saw it didn't take much time between when people saw Susan Boyle to when they made some decisions. Those just happen. And those are triggered by our brains needing to make those quick judgments. But they occur more frequently when we're under pressure, when we're multitasking, or when we're in a hurry. So you can probably all think of and imagine times where you've been like doing something, you're doing three things at the same time, and then something happens and you make a quick decision. And if you had maybe had more time or not been as much of a hurry, or were not under any certain pressures, or you're in a meeting and someone calls you out and you get defensive and you have a defensive reaction, it's much more likely that implicit bias would show up. And so those are, how do we kind of manage and pause in those moments so we can be sure that we're not allowing them to come and take over is kind of what we're going to be talking about today. So I'm going to have us take a minute and do a reflection break. And so Candy, I'll have you come back on to kind of help us think through how we're going to take some time to reflect on a specific scenario. So Candy, do you want to come on so we can have you lead this reflection?
Great. Thanks, Dr. O. So a couple of things we want you to be able to reflect on today. So really reflecting on your actual story. So we want you to think about a couple of things that you see on the slide here. So what is a significant event in your life that matters to you? Think about the following question. So how did this event shape your values and your worldview? How did this particular event affect the way you perceive others? And then how did it affect the way that you actually interact with others? This can be a wide range of things. And then also noting, how did this particular scenario, did this actually inform some of the biases that you have today? So again, take that time to reflect. And I think we're gonna want to hear either in the chat or from a volunteer about somebody who will be vulnerable enough to share and reflect on their story with us.
Hi, I'm Elizabeth Arturnanda. I think I was tapped to be vulnerable and share a little glimpse of my story today. Thank you all for being here and a fantastic presentation. I thought that I might talk about one thing, and then as I listened to your presentation and reflected, it drew me to speak more to my first role as a nurse was in the Jesuit Volunteer Corps, and I worked in a Native American health center. And what was really impactful to me and to be part of that community, I knew that I was a person who grew up very fortunate. I'm a Caucasian lady. I lived in a safe neighborhood in Louisville, Kentucky growing up. I was able to attend nursing school. So I think I had a general sense of all of the privilege that I had experienced in life. And then when I got to the Native American Health Clinic, I learned so much about gaining and experiencing that opportunity for bidirectional respect that isn't automatically given. It has to be earned. And just, it was the first time that I'd ever been met with a high level of suspicion around what my intention was. My intention was good. I signed up to be part of the volunteer corps. I lived in community. I worked for very little wage. We made $75 a month. And my goal was to be able to help people and contribute in a positive way to the world. But until the women and men and children who came into that health community got to know me and understood my intention as pure, it took me a really long time to build trust and rapport with that population of people. And for them to see me as someone that they would be willing to come to and trust them with their health needs. I think what it's done for me across my career, I ultimately went back to graduate school and became a psychiatric mental health provider. And so I think that what it did was helped me to understand that need to build rapport with people and not coming from a place of assuming that just because I come in the position of healthcare nurse provider, whatever my role might be, that I'm owed that trust, and that sometimes I have to work really hard to advocate and build relationship with people. So it was a really positive growth learning experience for me that was difficult to reflect on. Like, the people who hired me in to do that work trusted and knew that I was there for good intention, but that didn't mean that I got that automatically from the people that I was serving.
Thanks so much, Elizabeth. Just wanted to hone in on some of what I thought were some of the key points that stood out to me. There's intentionality to actually reflecting about your about everyone's implicit bias, but in terms of your particular story. And I think this is also a journey of reflection. So as you go through your careers, your everyday lives, you start to think about what you've experienced as an individual. We all know that this can contribute to some of the very specific individual implicit biases that we that you've developed and that we all have in different ways. So thank you again for being so vulnerable with us today.
Yes, Elizabeth, thank you so much for sharing that. And I really do appreciate something that you said in there, that how it has changed how you approach situations in the future. And I'm sure that that story and that experience has really been, it served you really well as a psychiatric mental health professional and in a place that's much needed. So thank you for sharing that and also kind of underscoring the importance of trust. Okay, so let's, you know, we're gonna go into some exercises so we can make sure you're with us. Just thinking through, you know, our implicit biases can be favorable or unfavorable, as we talked about. Favorable, often when people have the same characteristics that we have, our culture, religion, race. Unfavorable, people have characteristics that are different than us, may not, you know, enter, you know, these things. And when we think about the notion that everyone has these, they may not know exactly how to manage them. It's really important to think that that could also be your patients having those. And, you know, to Elizabeth's point, you know, what happens when you're a clinician and, you know, there are some questions about your intentions and your relationship with the patients as well. So thinking about it bi-directionally was really important. The thing is that, you know, they're there and they're like, you know, an iceberg right at the bottom. We don't know what's down there, but we know that something is down there, and we may not know that they're there, but we do need to be aware that they exist so that we can be careful that we don't bump into them and everything. So I'm gonna go through a couple of quick exercises with you all to just kind of get you thinking about some of this work and related to it. And so this is gonna be, you know, kind of all of us doing it from our computers. The first one is, you don't need to necessarily say this out loud. You can feel free to type in the chat if you are open to doing that. And I would say that I hope and believe that this is a safe space where we're not judging anyone, because we know that we all carry our biases and we're in agreement that is true. But if people share their thoughts, their real, true, raw, unfiltered thoughts, we want to embrace those, because we can learn together as we do that. So I'm going to put something on the screen, and there are a bunch of words on the screen. And this is just an exercise looking at, implicit biases that may exist for male and female. And so as you see some of these words, I would love for you to write the word, and if you're associating that with a male or female, in the chat, if you feel comfortable, or in your mind, make the associations that you might like. So which of these describes males or females? And so if you're comfortable, again, doing this in the chat, write the word and then write male or female that you see. And I see that people are doing it. So Debbie, maybe since you've done a good job of kind of looking through the chat, tell us what we're seeing here.
I'm seeing a lot of bossy female, tomboy female, female nurse. A lot of people are saying emotional female, jock is associated with male, foolish male. That's a funny one.
I didn't say that. I didn't say anything.
but a lot of the things you're saying are jocks or males.
Okay. So in a very, you know, short amount of time, we have things that we associate, you know, so we make those associations. Again, nothing bad or good about this. It's just those are associations that we make. And so sometimes when we see someone that looks a little bit different, like, oh, we see a male nurse or a female doctor or a female science teacher, we think, oh, okay, didn't expect that. And that's not necessarily a bad thing, but just shows you how quickly we make some decisions. Another one I'm gonna have you do is look at this picture. And understanding that our implicit biases are not just formed of things that are kind of our kind of genetic or religious or orientation perspective, even clothing and things like that can influence our perception. So what you see here is a young man who has different things that he's wearing through each of these pictures. And so I've labeled them as kind of A through F. And so I'm gonna ask you a series of questions. And so once I say, you know, which of these, I just want you to type in the chat, which letter you associate with this thing, you would associate this young man with, or would you? So which of these letters, these images here, would make you hold your purse a little bit tighter if this person were walking by you? And again, safe space, be honest. You know, I know that there are lots of thoughts and ways to think about this, but who would you hold your purse a little bit tighter? All right. Candy or Debbie, what are we?
Dr. O, it's flashing through lots of majority A's and B's.
Okay, all right, okay, great. Then who would you, if you have a daughter, precious daughter, who would you let take her to prom? You might not have a choice because she might go with whoever she wants anyway, but who would you be happy about if she wanted to go to prom?
A lot of D's and F's.
Okay. Okay. All right. Who would
One bold person said none of the above.
So. No one, yeah. Because we're not letting our daughters go to prom because they're not supposed to grow up. They're supposed to stay young and adorable and not do it. I have a 12-year-old daughter who's trying to be 13 next month, and I'm doing everything I can not to allow it. So I'm with you. Who would you interview for a job?
Everyone is saying F.
Okay. So F is getting hired. Okay. He's not taking our daughter to prom, but we might hire him for a job. So got it. And who would you have do some landscaping work at your house?
A lot of C's, a lot of D's.
Okay. Okay. All right. So we don't know this guy. He is probably a very nice young man who would probably do great taking our daughter to prom and working for us in landscaping. But you can see how we can quickly decide what we think about where someone could fit in our lives based on some of these characteristics. So just kind of asking ourselves to be conscious of that. And again, not saying that any of those thoughts that we have are bad for any reason, but just things that we need to be aware of. Now I'm going to have you do something else. So the next exercise is really, you don't need to write anything. I'm going to have you look at this and see if you can get through it. And if you do, just type in the chat, done. If you can understand what is on this next slide, just type in the chat, done. You don't have to type everything that you're seeing here. So are you ready for it? Okay, I'm going to pull it up. Are we seeing some people say done here, Debbie or Candy?
There are a ton of folks that said they're done. They're coming in.
Okay. So you all are very, very high performing, high achieving group. So you all can see that there is essentially gibberish written on this slide. But for some reason, your mind is able to put these things together. And it just shows how quickly we associate things that may not even necessarily be associated. And those mind bugs that we have and those kind of evolutionary things that we have developed to think we do it fast, we do it quickly. And this should not really make sense, but it does make sense to us because our mind is able to do lots of amazing things. So how can we train our mind to do things a little bit different when we might have unfavorable biases that would influence our ability to provide good care? And so we have to think, like, do we believe that implicit biases actually affect us in the workplace? You know, some people say, well, this isn't really here in healthcare. This is really more like I'm on the street, I'm at the mall, and I might form some judgments. I'm watching Susan Boyle on, you know, Britain's Got Talent. But they really do. And they show up in many, many forms in the workplace, how we interact with our patients, how we interact with their families, how we interact with our colleagues and members of our team, how we make decisions about roles and leadership and performance and standards. And so they can stand in the way of a lot of success that we have in our organization or as individuals. And so we've got to figure out how we recognize and mitigate them. And so there's some examples that we'd like to share with you, true examples, stories that we have collected that we think are really going to be helpful in you thinking about how implicit biases might show up in healthcare in particular. And so for this section, I'm going to have Candy and Debbie walk us through two cases and kind of give you some questions to think about, again, that are healthcare related. So Candy, you're first. You're on mute, Candy.
Sorry about that. So everyone, again, for this particular scenario, which I'm actually going to read off to you, there's like two specific questions that I want you to keep in mind. So number one, just really thinking about what are the biases that are showing up for this particular scenario. And for the second question, if you were in either Maria's place or somebody who is in that room or situation, what could we do to actually mitigate bias? How could we have changed the scenario? How can you show up as an ally? So I'm going to read the scenario aloud. Maria, a Filipina nurse manager, attends her first executive team meeting as part of the leadership team at her organization. During the meeting, she is asked to take notes and retrieve coffee. An administrative assistant was not in attendance at this meeting. In subsequent meetings, Maria is actively used in an administrative capacity despite being invited to the team meeting as part of the leadership team. When she finally raises the concerns with her boss, she is told that he did not know why she was making a big deal about it, and she was doing great at the note-taking. He told her that she is the most appropriate person to help support this team in this way. So would love to see in the chat, again, the two questions are, what biases are showing up and what could we do to change this? How could we address this if this was to happen in real life? So Kate had mentioned there's a racial and gender bias coming through. What else is happening? Okay, so cheap flattery, right? Keeping folks, quote unquote, in their place. There's maybe even a cultural bias coming up or a role bias. Maybe there might be something between, you know, Maria being a nurse. She's also the youngest. Oh, and Lori said, was there anyone else in the meeting that's also a woman? And then talking about, somebody else had mentioned, what's the rationale between that person being the appropriate person? And then Laura said, yikes, is he serious? So age, gender, and role bias is really coming up and showing through. So thank you. And also, she's the newest. So is this like, you know, is this a hazing ritual? What kind of culture do we have here? So Dr. O, to you, but I think we've had some great feedback so far.
Thank you. And just to emphasize, although these are real true stories that we have gathered, these are not the actual people, their pictures or their names, just to be clear. So that's a kind of a workplace colleague one. I'm going to have Debbie take you through another one, which is actually a very recent experience that we have heard about. And it's a person that many of us know. And so this one is a little bit personal, but we thought it'd be really important to share this next one. And so this is about a patient related one. So Debbie, I'm gonna turn this one over to you.
Thank you, Dr. Nwando. And it's gonna be the same thing. I'm gonna ask before we read this that we keep two questions in mind. What are the biases that are showing up? And how could you as a healthcare provider have done something to mitigate the bias and possibly get a different outcome? So here we have a 34-year-old Black woman, G1 P0, presented to the emergency department at 20 weeks gestational age, complaining of severe lower abdominal pain and cramping. She presented to the ED walking, but over the course of her time there, the pain was excruciating. She was told that there were no doctors available to examine her and she should calm down. A pelvic exam was not done. An ultrasound was not done. She was sent home, requiring a wheelchair to take her to the lobby. She went back to the hospital the next day and was sent home again. Less than 24 hours later, she went back to the hospital in pain. She felt she needed to have a bowel movement, and then her infant was birthed in the ED toilet. The infant died less than 3 hours after birth, and she was taken for emergency placental evacuation. So the first question again is, what are the biases that showed up in taking care of this patient? I'm seeing age, cultural, racism, discounting the pain that that this woman is feeling. Her gender is playing a role as well. Yep, I'm seeing a lot of people saying that pain is often discounted. This is total malpractice, and reminder, this is a true case. Absolutely. And then the next question is gonna be, how could we as healthcare providers have done something different? Where are time points in this case where things could have been different? Someone is saying that she should have been sent to the OB floor to be evaluated rather than the ED. Absolutely. So really making sure that she's in the appropriate location, providing the same care to all patients, standardizing practice for when patients report pain, following protocol. I strongly believe in that. Considering her actual symptoms without bias, essentially believing her pain. Absolutely. And just kind of like to anchor this discussion, Dr. Nwando really talked about the longstanding health disparities that exist in obstetrics and gynecology. And I think some of the things that really culturally require us to understand is over the past two decades, maternal morbidity and mortality have been declining around the world, except for in the United States. And this is the only developed country in which this has occurred. And that really emphasizes that there is something that's going on outside of socioeconomic status, outside of age, outside of gender, outside of all these things that are influencing these adverse health outcomes. All right, I'm going to pass it back.
Thank you so much, Debbie. And thank you to all of you for engaging in that. Definitely hard when these are real stories that we know of, and these are real people's lives. It's not just, you know, kind of words on a page. So thank you for that. We have one more case we wanted to talk to. This is more of an organizational one. So this is, again, another true story. We want to share this. I'm going to have Debbie lead us through the conversation around this final case.
Absolutely. So this is an effort, essentially. This entire session is an effort to address our implicit biases. But sometimes we miss the mark. Like sometimes we are well-intentioned and we want to be the best, but sometimes it doesn't happen in the way that we desire it to be. So this is a case of a prominent hospital that wanted to do the best and address racism structurally and implicit bias and honor those who come from a marginalized background during Black History Month. So I'll just read some of the things that were posted. Things that they wanted to do to explore the Black History Month. They wanted everybody to put their photos in a document and take a selfie or a signature of a Black person in leadership, selfie with a Black clinical staff member, selfie with a participant of the program, with a Black pharmacist, with the D&I director, with other leaders and mentors. So I'm already reading the group and people are saying, this is terrible, so demeaning. Can you say token? Wow, this really happened. Absolutely, right? So my question initially was gonna be, what are we feeling? What are the impressions, right? And I'm seeing that this is stomach turning. This is aggravating. But at the same time, this was well-intentioned.
This was last month. Yeah, it was last month at a hospital. So yeah, Debbie, I just want to make sure that it's clear that this is literally happened.
Okay. Literally February of 2023. yeah. So the question becomes, and I'll pose this to the chat, how could this organization have done something differently? What are some things that organizations can do that honor that they're acknowledging implicit biases, that are celebrating Black history, and that are moving the needle towards change?
And while people are typing the chat, I'll just add that this was sent to folks, all the staff at a hospital, and interesting, lots of lots of folks went and ultimately complained about it. And so it wasn't just the Black folks at the hospital, but it was lots of folks that just said that they think, as to Debbie's point, intentions were probably good. Like, we're trying to figure out how do we celebrate and make people feel that we're recognizing the month, but just one of those ways where we're kind of missed the mark here. So,
yeah.
So Debbie, anything else you want to throw out there?
Yeah, I'm just reading the chat, and a lot of people are advocating for diversity and inclusion in leadership in the planning process for this. Perhaps Absolutely. If those voices were there, this wouldn't have been an issue.
Yep.
Other people are saying to give facts, to encourage reading. Things that I just want to add that haven't been said in the chat yet are thinking about supply chains and using that month to highlight whether this organization is working with businesses that are also doing the work to address underrepresentation and leading by example, creating a culture where everyone knows what is and isn't acceptable behavior, and really like making this an inclusive environment so that no one feels marginalized during a time where they're supposed to feel celebrated.
Yeah, great. Thank you so much. And thank you all for your participation in those cases. So now we're going to just kind of turn ourselves to like, okay, so what can we do? So one of the first things that you can certainly do is understand what biases you might have and which ones that you might not be aware of that you can potentially do something about. I'm not going to spend tons of time on the tools to actually assess the bias, because I think that you had a chance to do that. And I remember the very first time I did one of those IATs, I was stunned because I thought, well, I'll do this because I don't have bias. I talk about this stuff all the time and I help people work through them, but I don't have them. So when I did it, I thought, oh my gosh, yes, I do. And I need to lean into even getting myself in better position to address them. And so I think that would be a great thing for us to start talking about now. So like when you want to think about, you know, what can you do to increase your understanding? You know, ask yourself, like, what am I thinking? Why am I thinking it? Is there a past experience that's influencing my current decision? And is that past experience relevant anymore? Is it based on something else? And so sometimes I find myself when I have certain reactions to people, like think of those reactions that I have that are really quick, and I'm just like, oh, I just don't like. I ask myself, whoa, Nwando, what? Why do you think that? What is it about, you know, this person that is making you react so negatively? And it is showing up in the way you're talking. Sometimes I can feel it in my skin, like that I just don't like someone for some reason, and I don't know why, and I don't know what they did. And I can feel sometimes when people have that same reaction to me. So got to really ask myself, what is it that's here that's making me feel this way? So this is, you know, some things that can help you do this is, you know, having self-awareness. And that's kind of what we're doing today. Like just being aware that we all have them. They're rooted in some of our preferences. Some of them are rooted in kind of like a fight or flight, friend or foe type history. And we need that. But we have to try to figure out, how do we manage the behaviors that result from having them? How we respond, when we take responsibility. And to the point that was made, I think in the last case, like building cultural awareness, learning more about others and other groups and what they need. And Elizabeth's story earlier, she couldn't just walk into that that community health center with the indigenous patients that she was taking care of and just expect trust. She had to learn about them and grow herself and grow before she could get that trust. So learning more about other cultures that are not like yours is really, really important. And I would argue that those are things that should also happen within cultural groups that you do identify with. So for example, you know, I'm a Black woman from an immigrant family. I would not in any way say that means I understand everything that Black women from immigrant families experience. I'm not the voice for all of them. I'm not the right person. There are as many differences between me and other, you know, Black women of my background as there are between me and Asian women that are not my background. So we have to be open to even learning about cultures within our subcultures and being respectful of them and all things. When you think about how you interact with patients, your coworkers, whoever your customer might be, your members of a community, you've got to be aware of those triggers in yourself. And remember that you're going to be more likely to favor people who are like you. So your daughter brings home this guy she wants to take to prom. He seems like your son or your brother, and you like him. But if he's not, then what, you know, how are you going to respond? How are you going to act without making assumptions? What can you do to help allow yourself to learn? Being aware, and this is a thing that I have to work on. I remember when I was a kid all the time, my parents would say, like, it was so obvious when my younger sister was mad because she would say it and I would never say it, but I would, my body language would be telling them, and they'd be like, how are you? I'm fine. Yeah, I'm fine. You know, but they could feel it. So like, what is your body language saying, even if you're not saying it, and then make decisions based on facts rather than instincts. So the more you get to know and embrace differences among people around you, the better able you'll be to make decisions based on facts. So how you can do this, there are a lot of tools out there. I really love some of the work that is been done by the National Center for Cultural Competence at Georgetown, where they talk a lot about how you interrupt biases, both those conscious and unconscious biases. They've given us a lot of tools that you can use to ask. So first you've got to like do some probing questions to like confront those biases. So, you know, and for those of you that are in direct clinical care, some of the things you might want to think about are, do my biases and, you know, how they might show up, do they impact how much time I spend with my patients? Am I spending more time with people who look like me or sound like me or have the same, you know, socioeconomic situation as me or went to the same high school as me or whatever it might be? Do they influence how I communicate with patients and their families? And that silent curriculum article that I mentioned that the medical student wrote from Brown in 2015 in JAMA, she talks a lot about how she would see the way people communicated, the doctors, the attendings that she had would communicate with people of different backgrounds automatically. And they would give more information about informed consent for procedures to people that they felt were more like them, and they would not do the same for others. So does it show up in how you're communicating? Does it stand in your way of feeling empathy? You know, do you see this 34-year-old Black woman come to the emergency room at 20 weeks gestation? She's complaining of pain. And you're just like, well, sorry, no one can talk to you. No one can see you, you know, go back and follow up with someone. And you just don't have that empathy. Like the empathy doesn't show up because of you're something standing in your way. Does it show up in the way what treatment you recommend and medications that you recommend? If you saw a different person, would you say, oh my gosh, we need to get them on the OB floor and have them have an evaluation, get them out of the emergency room, get them to the OB folks? Would you have done that? And maybe if you would have, then we need to think about like what stopped me from doing that? And does that stand in your way? Also ask ourselves, do I feel like I'm less comfortable with patients who are of a different background from me? And that could be race, ethnicity, that could be any sort of other orientation, any other part of their identity. Are there people that you work with that do they think that your attitudes or behaviors demonstrate bias? And this is always a really good one to check, because you might think you're doing great and you don't have an orientation or a lean towards anyone, but it might be, and this is a pulse check that I try to do with some of my leaders that report to me. I will ask them sometimes, how am I showing up? You know, and do you feel like I'm showing up in a way that everyone feels that they're part of this team and that the culture is one for them? And you have to ask that question and be willing to get the answer, because there are sometimes I get these answers and I think, well, geez, you know, I thought I was totally inclusive of all voices or making people feel comfortable, but I'm not, and I'm missing the mark. And so being willing and having some humility to ask other people, is this showing up? You know, you're on a care team and you work in a dyad or a triad or something. You could say like, how do you see me when I'm, you know, interacting with different people? And that could be just a really great pulse check for you. And there are other things that are, you know, patient satisfaction surveys, you know, are people actually saying things? Now those ones usually, by the time something gets to a point where someone wants to mention it in a patient satisfaction survey, it's either that you were fantastic and they just could not help but give that feedback, or you are completely the opposite. And so doing these things, having people that you trust be able to give you honest, direct feedback is a really good way to also ask yourself some of those questions. The another thing is that there's a kind of a six intervention thing to think about, you know, acknowledging that implicit bias exists, assume responsibility for your own biases, be willing to engage in self-reflection and self-assessment, explore like the different sciences to combat some of the things that are hardwired into you, you know, and you may need to think through like, what are some things that, you know, maybe happened when you were 6 years old that are ingrained in your memory that continue to inform your views, and how do you kind of change some of your perspectives around those? Continue to collect data, whether that's patient experience data, staff data, 360s on you as a leader, asking those questions of your colleagues to help you kind of understand how you're showing up. And then incorporate some of these, you know, cultural, linguistic competency and humility practices into your practice, whatever that practice might be. Another, you know, thing is like, you know, once you've acknowledged that acceptance and recognize that, recognize that like it does have a direct impact on, you know, physician clinicians, our ability to fulfill the oath that we've all taken. Similar codes of ethics for all sorts of clinicians exist. And so recognize that that's really, really important. So when you think through like, gosh, some of these things I'm saying or doing or the reactions I'm having could actually be associated with harm. That's not aligned with the oath that I've taken or the code of ethics that I have. But I also want to ask you to make sure you think through, don't guilt yourself into thinking that you are not a good person, you don't have good intentions, because we are all on a journey. And for every single bias you might have, there's probably a very good reason why that showed up in your life. And so we want to make sure that you just start thinking, we can't do something about why some of these experiences or encounters have happened, but what can I do going forward? And there are solutions. So here are some things that you can do. And we're going to kind of practice on some of this with as you go through your action plan. You can think through, what are these things could I possibly do? What are the beliefs that you have that might lead to biased thoughts towards people? Ask some of your colleagues to do this. That's a very practical one. Again, ask people that you know will tell you the truth and that you will be okay when you get the answer, even if it's not what you said. And don't ask them in a leading way, like, hey, I'm pretty inclusive and respect cultures, right? Right. It's more like, I'd love to know your thoughts on, you know, how I'm showing up if I'm creating an environment that embraces diversity and inclusion. And that's a different way of asking that question. Make a personal commitment after you've done that reflection to come at those and how in your care, participate in things like this. So I think it's great that so many of you have decided to do this and actually can get some tools in your toolkit. And then continue to advocate for sessions like this in places that you are. So maybe you're in a professional society meeting for mental health, and you're a mental health practitioner. You know, you're in those environments in addition to your maybe your hospital affiliations. Are there places you can raise awareness in those areas as well? How does this show up in my blank specialty? How does this show up in my conferences? Am I planning things? Am I on planning committees of things where I could help bring some content and some tools for people? And then this is one from the from Vanderbilt. They've got this PAWS framework. Again, things that you can do kind of every day to disrupt bias and the things that show up. And they describe PAWS as an acronym for pay attention, acknowledge your assumptions, understand your perspective, but seek different perspectives and examine your options and make a decision. And so that's kind of like the PAWS framework as we think through that. So one really important thing in all of these is that you've got to do something different and be committed to trying to do something different and making a change. So we're going to close out this session with this last piece with Candy kind of walking you through what we started with in the beginning, which is how do we get to an action plan, and hope that we'll have the opportunity to hear from you as we take a little bit of time to reflect before we do it. So Candy, I'm going to turn it over to you to take this part.
Thanks, Dr. O. So just a friendly reminder, we've gone through a lot today in today's workshops. So some of the context of how biases show up, what some of our how this impacts our health system so far. We've engaged in some dialogue, gone through activities, looked at scenarios. And so now this is like, we want to really bring this back to you. And again, like, what can you do moving forward from today? So what we're going to do is I'm going to review the implicit bias action plan in detail. And then we actually have a wonderful volunteer named Pam, and we're actually going to go through the form so you can have a modeling moment to see how somebody has gone through this to create an action plan for that individual. So Dr. Can we go to the next slide? So again, here's the action plan. The action plan worksheet. It's pretty simple to fill out. The first step is to literally ask yourself one question. What is one thing that I will change or do to address my own implicit bias? Below here is a couple of different considerations just for you to think about if you're having a hard time coming up with an idea. So is the action something that you specifically want to work on? Not that you're pressured to do this, but is there something that's been on your mind, maybe from the workshop, maybe you've had other ideas that have been brewing, but what is it that you want to work on and you feel passionate about? Is this action specific? So is this a pie in the sky kind of dream where you're going to change the whole system? Or is this something that you can specifically do that is in your control within the next 1 to 2 weeks. And maybe you're going to build on those specific actions to reach your larger goal. But what can you specifically do now? And then is this action feasible for me to follow through on? So do you have the right tools in place? Or is this something that is, again, in your control and that you have some skin in the game in? The next step is to really think about, after you've come up with that initial idea, is like, basically want to gut check this, right? Am I setting myself up for success? So step two is really all about, what else do you need to think about for your action plan to be successful? So a couple of things for you to think about here. It's really about, when are you going to actually make this change? So is this something that you want to do a year from now, a month from now, or is this something that you can work on this very week? And I would encourage you to start with what is in front of you right now. What can you do in the next week to two so that it is real? What resources do you need to make this change? So is this, again, something that you want to change within a system, or are you wanting to make changes in your everyday life that may not cost anything, that you can just move forward with? And then really thinking about, what barriers stand in your way and how do you address those barriers? So again, if it's a system change that you want to work on, you may have, we're all in systems. We all have to go through red tape to potentially get particular outcomes or get resources. But there are things that you can do that potentially, if your action plan is on an individual level, things that you don't need to work with anyone on. So just keeping those types of things involved at the top of mind too. And then the next question is, how are you going to actually measure your progress? So once you're doing something, how do you know you're going to be successful? And again, that's going to depend on what you decide. If it's making a log based on, doing a particular action or asking a specific question with the patients that you encounter, that's going to be one thing, versus setting up a program at the organizational level and actually having an evaluation plan to go along with that. And then the last question is, who can hold you and me accountable for these actions? I think a lot of the time, just like we do with, patients with, something like weight loss, it often helps to have an accountability partner to share ideas, or even just to give updates on, again, what can we subtly do to keep ourselves accountable so that we move forward. And then the third step is really thinking about all of this. How confident do you feel? So on a scale of 0 to 10, what is that confidence rating? And so if you're, here's the guidelines as they've been noted here. If you rate yourself from 7 to 10, you're good to go. If you're from 4 to 6, you might have some just thinking to do. Maybe you could get a little bit more confident. So how can we refine the action plan? And then if you rate yourself 3 and below, to me, and I think across the board, if you've done action planning, that means I think we have some work to do. So I would really go back and consider, is this something that you, again, actually want to work on? And if not, it's okay to change. Action plans can change all of the time. You just start over. So I see Pam is with us. So Pam, would love for you to share we can go through the steps together. So Pam, what did you want to work on?
Yes. So I want to frame this up by telling you a quick story about my experience at a young age in high school, and then why I've been working on this already and will continue. So nearly 40 years ago, when I was in high school, meeting with my high school counselor, deciding on what I was going to pursue as my career and study in college, I mentioned I was passionate about two things, and deciding upon pre-law, political science, or nursing, having an affinity to both of them and lots of reasons why I wanted, either of those. I was quickly discouraged on the pre-law political science and very quickly encouraged to go the route of nursing, because that was mostly a female profession, and that I could also consider education, teaching, or dental hygienist. I'm very, very happy that I pursued my career in nursing and eventually into leadership and healthcare, but it has changed the way that I look at, as I've mentored over the years, many many individuals, whether they are young or older in their, you know, in their career, and it's a second or third career, but I have really encouraged them to pursue their passion, and that really the sky is the limit. And social norms, even though we've gotten better, they're still there. And these implicit biases exist. And what I would say for this, I think that, you know, I do a check, a recheck on myself, because even though that happened to me in my experience, I'm ultra aware, but I have also, just the way that I was, you know, raised and grew up, I had this all around me. And so I would give myself probably a 7 here, that I still need to just seek awareness, understanding, acknowledge, and act upon things. So I hope that's helpful.
And great. And Pam, so what I would say to you is, I know you're still working on things. If we just take this back to the form. So what, if I was just working with you, what is, from here on out, knowing all of that context and background, what is specifically one thing that you specifically want to work on? Do you have any ideas about that?
Yes. I think that, it's probably seek to understand, stopping and listening and just really growing my own knowledge, with individuals and in the industry. And especially I think around gender, because that happened to me, that I'm very, that I need to still be very conscientious of that.
Great. So Pam, I'm going to ask you one more follow-up. So again, getting really specific. So you want to seek to understand and do some reading. Specifically, are there going to be specific, how are you going to go about that? Are you going to go, like, do you have any resources in mind? Are you going to read about journals? What specifically do you want to work on?
Sure. So then some of the action items would be that, yes, look to the evidence-based literature, do some journal reading, and then talk to individuals, go out and kind of test that knowledge and get their feedback of what I'm learning through my research.
And Pam, if you were going to do all, like, these are all great ideas. If you can pick one of those things to do this week, talking to individuals, reading, what would you specifically want to work on just for this week?
Reading. That okay. would be the research and doing the reading.
Great. And then Pam, when are you actually going to do the reading? So you have a busy day. I know you're a busy professional. Is this going to be something outside of work, or are you going to carve out time? When do you think you're going to do that?
It will be this weekend, but then I will also have some time on my calendar, maybe even during my lunch hour, beginning of next week as well.
Okay. And Pam.
Oh, I love that. I love that you identify like a place on your calendar that could show up. I think that's also good. It's like, not just I'm going to do it, but this is the time. So that's great. Great, Pam. Sorry, Kate.
I want to say no problem.
I love that.
What do you have anything that you are going to read? So do you have access to the journal, the magazine, the book? Do you need any other resources to do that reading?
Yes. And if through this webinar today, I would love to find out more if you have, you know, recommended reading. And I think there are some references, but yeah. I'll also do my own research and even get with our librarian through Norton Healthcare, whether it's systematic review, et cetera. But we'll definitely do my due diligence on that piece.
Oh, and Pam, thank you so much for being willing to be a partner here. And so I think you all just saw in real life, this is some of the work that Candy does. She's a really good facilitator. And Pam, thank you so much for being willing to step up and offer, and also for having some real concrete things that you're excited about doing. But you see that it's that level of specificity that often helps us really make a change. I think we all know as clinicians, those of you that are clinicians, that when you talk to your patients and they say, I'm going to lose weight, you know, we'll say, that's great. How are you going to do it? And the more specific they get about it, the much more likely they are to actually do it. So I think, you know, Pam literally has who she wants to talk to. She's going to identify librarians. She's going to tap into some of the resources we're going to add to the thing. She's got a time dedicated that she's thinking about this weekend, time on her calendar that she's going to block. And all those things are really, really important to be able to make sure that you're going to likely take action on it. So Pam, thank you so much for being willing to serve as a volunteer to go through that exercise with Candy.
Thank you.
So we are at the end. I think we have some time for questions. We do want to just thank you all so much for your time, your really incredible engagement in the chat. I didn't get to look at a lot of it, but I'm hearing a lot about it and hearing my colleagues share with me. So I think we have time to open up the floor for a few questions.
Yes.
Okay.
We already have some in the chat. So
okay.
I did want to start with some questions to clarify some terminology that folks didn't understand. So the first was, what is linguistic competence?
Yes, that's great. I'm so glad that you asked us to clarify. So it's essentially similar to cultural competence, recognizing and understanding and being empathetic around people that don't necessarily have speak the same language as you. And so, you know, we won't necessarily, so you've seen stories and heard things about how people, if they don't speak English, let's just say we're, you know, countries probably speak English, they are not treated with respect because they don't speak English. And that could be people from all over the world. And so you hear people yelling at people that don't speak English or screaming louder because they think they don't understand or thinking they're not as smart. So building kind of some empathy around the importance of embracing differences in language and not using them as things that kind of judge or marginalize people.
Okay. And that sounds like it's something to also keep in mind for patients who might have an accent as well.
Yes, absolutely. Yep. Yep.
Thank you. An additional question from one of our listeners today is, do you see a shift in disrespect for parents, teachers, authority figures being related to a generational bias?
Look, I'm not sure I totally understand the question. So
I guess their question is more about a generational bias. Yeah. And if like a younger generation is looking to parents and teachers and authority figures in a different way because of a generational bias. So again, more of a question to clarify that definition of generational bias.
Yeah, well, I certainly think there are generational biases. So I mentioned earlier, I'm the parent of two kids, a 16-year-old boy and a 12-year-old girl. And I think that a lot of times I catch myself sometimes saying like, your generation just does this, or you guys are so quick to this, you can't wait to like, you know, you have to have a response right away. Like, and there are probably some biases, and there are certainly some the other way. So I definitely think that generational bias is another form of bias we should think about. Like when we collectively say, and I know we human beings, we have to put things in groups and we have to put them in compartments so we can understand them. So we say, you know, Generation X and Generation Z and the millennials, and this is how they are. We think that they're all the same. And I think that we need to be just really careful that we recognize that even within any, whatever kind of group we're defining, as I was mentioning earlier, there are lots of different perspectives. I personally think I'm right all the time with my kids. And so, and that their generation is wrong, but I won't tell them that. You don't tell them that either, please.
Got it. And that also leads into some of the ageism questions that were in the chat as well. So definitely something for all of us to keep in mind.
Yeah.
Another clarifying question was, what is it called if you see one race wearing a particular outfit and a different race individual wearing that same outfit, but you have completely different reactions to that individual? Would that still be considered a bias?
Oh, that's such a great question. What a thoughtful question. And I think that's why it was interesting to think through that young man that we showed and all the different outfits that he wore, because sometimes things are, it's not just about like the thing, but who's wearing it. So, you know, I'll use an example that's probably one that people could relate to. If you see, you know, a young Black male wearing a hoodie and, you know, maybe a young white boy wearing a hoodie, you may not have the same reaction to the same hoodie. And there are a lot of reasons why, you know, and how we've been socialized to think certain things, or we might've had experiences that lead us to certain things. You might not think the same thing, even though the article of clothing is the same. And so I would argue, depending on what that is, that we might be carrying biases even that are deeper than just the clothing. So I think for that one person, we just looked at a person with the one person with different clothing all the way through, but you could take any of those and put them in two different people and have very different reactions to those as well. So thank you for asking that. And I would argue that, yes, that is definitely a place where you could see bias.
Perfect. And then the additional question that got asked was in regards to some of the data you shared about infant mortality and maternal mortality. And so our listener was curious if those rates are shifting given that Black families and other families are using doulas more. Do you have any thoughts on that?
I would say, and I'll see what our budding OBGYN who's done a lot of work in there has to say too as well. But I will just offer that the doula model is still very much emerging, and for the most part, often an out of pocket, not necessarily covered expense by lots of different plans. So I don't know if we know enough yet that we've seen the changes that we're hoping with that. I know that the model has great promise, high level of satisfaction, great level of safety with birthing experiences, but I still think it's probably early for us to know kind of the long-term impacts of that. But Debbie, do you want to add anything to that?
Yeah, the only thing I was going to say is they did a recent study that came out to assess maternal morbidity and mortality up until 2021. And that still showed that for Black women, the rates of MMM, maternal morbidity and mortality, are getting worse. But then also to speak to the doula perspective, I do love doulas and I think that they're great. But I think that they really speak to the implicit bias, the provider to patient relation. And they don't necessarily account for the structural systemic racism that goes into housing and healthcare and really the upstream or downstream factors. So I think that there's still a lot of work that needs to be done.
Perfect. Thank you. An additional question is, do you all know of any studies on the population regarding addiction and the barriers they've encountered with healthcare professionals labeling them and how that impacts their sobriety?
That's a really good question. I'm so glad somebody asked that. We're doing a lot of work right now around recovery for people who struggle with addiction. And I would say that is one area where our language and our words and our stigma has been so, so marginalizing and disenfranchising, because we tend to think of addiction as bad choices, as opposed to illness. And so there's a lot of opportunity for us to really think through if we think of addiction as a behavioral health challenge that people experience, then we would orient ourselves around kind of solutions rather than judgment. So that is definitely a population of folks that carry a diagnosis that leads to a lot of stigmatizing behavior from healthcare professionals. Very, very similar to, earlier in the, HIV AIDS epidemic when the illness itself was so heavily stigmatized that it made people have a hard time receiving care. And then, add those other intersections of people's identity, poverty, race, ethnicity, religious minorities, all those things to it, then it also kind of compounds that thing. So yeah, but it's definitely an important question.
And our last question is, how do you feel social media has affected bias?
Oh my gosh. Well, Candy, Debbie, I would certainly love your answer. I'm currently, for Lent, I gave up Twitter, which I'm very active on. And I will say it has been very refreshing, honestly, to kind of just like not have some of the inputs that I have. Not to say that I won't ever go back, but I'd love to hear what my colleagues think.
Yeah, I'm actually quite energized by the new generation. I think that's Gen Z that's out now. I think that they are very much so a introspective and reflective generation. They're a very loud and demanding generation in terms of the fact that they are really energized towards change. I think that what we're seeing from this generation is just like an energy that I personally haven't experienced before, that's challenging existing systems, that's acknowledging failures both internally and then also structurally. So I think that because of this generation, these conversations are being had on a much deeper and much more frequent level.
I'm just going to bring it back to social media. I know it can be a tool to potentially skew your perspective in one particular way, but I would also say it's also a tool to learn about different perspectives and actually intentionally learn about what somebody else is thinking about, no matter that may be very similar or different to your perspective. And I think it's one way to leverage it.
Perfect.
I want to add one more thing to that, because I think it's important. With social media, there's also this concept of cancel culture, which it can go either way. It's either, you know, we're canceling people for the right reasons, or prejudging and canceling people for the wrong reasons as well. But I still do think that cancel culture is speaking to this generation's desire to hold people accountable and to really demand more of its leaders, its learners, and everyone in between.
Perfect. Thank you all so much for your time today. Thank you, Dr. Nwando, Debbie, and Candy, on spending this time and this learning experience with us. Thanks to all of you for being present and being available for this conversation. This was one of your action steps in tackling your own implicit bias. So thank you all for being present.